The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Frank Conniff joins us. It's been a while. Dave Sirus is also with us and hopefully will be with us all the time. And Frank Conniff, it's great to see you. You know Frank Conniff from Tell Me Everything, Channel 121 on Sirius.
Mm-hmm.
You should have Sirus on Sirius.
That would he should have a show only because it could have that title.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Movie Sign with the Mads. That's mm-hmm. your new podcast, Frank.
That's a podcast I do with Trace Bellew and Carolina Hidalgo, where we just talk about movies. Good movies, bad movies, weird movies, just an hour-long discussion about movies every week.
And why is it called the Mads?
Because Trace Bellew and I were known as the Mads on Mystery Science Theater, and Movie Sign is a catchphrase from Mystery Science Theater. It's called branding.
Okay. You're also an author. Your new book is mm-hmm. 25 Mystery Science Theater Movies That Changed My Life in No Way Whatsoever.
Yes.
And how can people buy this book?
They can get it at Amazon, and it's on paperback and Kindle there. And also when I do shows, Trace Bellew and I do live movie riffing shows. We're going to be at the Logan Theater in Chicago on December 9th. And I always have copies of the books with me that I sell and sign.
You're also the writer, producer of Podhouse 90.
Yes. A new episode is coming soon. We just a few minutes ago, we recorded a segment with Mike McRae as Barack Obama. It's a scripted radio plays that I produce, and I do about one a year. And this year's episode hopefully will be it's almost done, and hopefully it'll be out before 2017.
And you have a great Twitter feed and Facebook feed that mm-hmm. people should just stay on top of.
Oh, thanks. Yeah.
What's it like to be loved?
I don't know if it's not enough to be loved. You have to be well-loved, to paraphrase Willie Loman.
Oh, okay. Dave Sirus.
Hello.
Is a brilliant comedy writer.
Oh, thank you.
And you've written on SNL
mm-hmm.
and Triumph the Incel Comic Dog.
Mm-hmm.
And Brickstone is your alter ego?
Yeah. That was a YouTube thing I was doing up until I started working at SNL.
And who was Brickstone?
Basically, I made a bad decision of using a different name for something that was, now I realize, not even close to being a character. It's just me being a dick to people. I would just go to interview people. Started out as making fun of people, like Lie Witness News, though I was doing it before Jimmy Kimmel had that show. And then it became mostly about me counter-harassing hate groups whenever I could get my hands on them, whenever they would be nice enough to say where they're going to be and when. I would just go and I would just try to have a conversation until they got mad and left.
We talked about Westboro. Besides Westboro, what other hate groups?
The real street preachers, Reuben Israel, who is now a Trump surrogate. They were the people who would tend to go to all the gay pride parades with the signs about, you know, anal sex and you're all going to go to hell, that sort of thing. And I've also done some stuff like that through Skype with conspiracy people, when I would try to find the most prolific conspiracy theorists on YouTube and try to make them look bad.
Hmm. I've stood up to hate groups.
Mm-hmm.
Thanksgiving dinner. How was your Thanksgiving, Frank?
I had a lovely Thanksgiving with my brother Tony and my sister-in-law, Amy, and my niece and nephew, Asher and Emma. And
Asher, is this a – don't do that, please.
Uh-huh.
Because that makes noise.
Mm-hmm. Asher, yes, my nephew and my
niece. Is that an intermarriage? Is that a Jew?
It is an intermarriage.
Jew?
My sister-in-law is a Jew, yes. She is a member of the tribe.
Mm-hmm. And do they celebrate Thanksgiving?
Every day is Thanksgiving in a Jewish household. I was telling Amy, I feel like I am an honorary Jew. Well, one, because I'm a comedian, and also because I love eating food so much.
And talking about it.
Yes.
And talking. Was there a crazy uncle at your...
That was me.
Why?
Because I was the uncle of my niece. But I don't think they thought I was crazy. They're both It was a lot of consensus about things.
That's boring. Who wants that Thanksgiving?
It was very boring.
Yeah, mine was mostly more left than usual this year. Less people defending the Republicans than typically at Thanksgiving.
All right, let's get right to it. Let's just talk about it and 'cause it's important. How do my hair plugs look? I have a class reunion tonight. No. Okay, Trump, the recount. Why are the Democrats dragging their feet? Jill Stein, who ran on the Green Party ticket, is demanding a recount in Wisconsin, Michigan.
Why the fuck is Jill Stein demanding? Where was she before the election when she should have said, okay, you know what? I'm dropping out. Everybody should vote for Hillary. And now she wants to help Hillary? It just strikes me as a bunch of crap.
It just seems like she suddenly realized, oh, I'm the most hated person in America right now. What can I do about that?
Is she being Ralph Nader'd?
Oh, yeah. Well, not, she deserves it more than Nader does. Because
really?
Because Nader wasn't going around saying the kinds of things about Gore that Stein was saying about Clinton.
That's a good point. I hadn't even thought about that.
This is all new to me.
She was saying that Hillary Clinton was more dangerous than Trump,
yes.
More of a war hawk. You know, she was bomb throwing just like Trump does and just trying to say anything she could think of to get more people to just be disillusioned with the two-party system and, you know, have a protest vote for her.
Exactly.
So I have much more resentment. I mean, look, I resented the hell out of Nader in 2000, but I think I had more anger at her because I thought Nader at least was being somewhat intellectually honest about why you should vote for him. And he was also not doing things like she was doing, like pandering to truthers and anti-vaccine people, which made me sick.
Yes.
It's amazing. I paid zero attention to Jill Stein during this election.
As
zero.
Did most people.
Zero attention.
I have a lot of anger at truthers. Especially, and I have even more anger at people who don't believe that 9/11 was an inside job, but will placate people who do.
All right, so fill me in. Jill Stein, Dr. Jill Stein, ran on the Green Party. Tell me about her, because I had zero interest in her.
Well, I think you had exactly the right attitude. She was not never a serious candidate. And the Green Party is not really a serious. I describe the Green Party as cosplay politics. they're not serious about making change. I don't know what their motivations are, but they take someone like Jill Stein, who I think she ran for, you know, school board or something, and they.
Is she a real doctor?
She is a real doctor, but they run her as a presidential candidate. They don't. They focus very little on where they should be, which is local elections, which is building their party from the ground up. And one of the major sources of my resentment towards the Greens is they ran a candidate against Paul Wellstone in Minnesota. So to me, they're not serious. To me, the Green Party is just a bullshit party of people pretending to participate in politics. I'm sure that's not true of everyone in the Green Party, but on the whole, the Green Party is not I don't take it seriously at all, except that it can do harm to the only thing the Green Party ever achieves is doing harm to progressive causes.
Had Jill Stein. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, if you think Paul Wellstone isn't left enough, then you don't know what the hell you're talking about.
Yeah.
If any Democrat deserved the respect of the far left, it was Paul Wellstone.
Yes, exactly. He makes Bernie look like a John Bircher.
Wellstone was the senator from Minnesota who died in a plane crash.
Yes.
And I think Walter Mondale took his seat temporarily.
Well, he tried to take his seat. I think he might have maybe had it temporarily, but he was not elected to succeed him. Though.
And Coleman took the seat?
I'm not sure about that.
I think that was Norm Coleman.
Yeah, Norm Coleman.
Who then lost to Franken.
To Franken. Mm-hmm. Had Jill Stein not been on the ticket in Wisconsin, would Hillary have won Wisconsin?
I'm not sure about that.
She got about 1% of the vote.
She got more votes than Hillary needed, but you can't.
And another thing, too, is I'm not – the idea that Jill Stein – that Hillary would have won if not for Jill Stein, I don't know if that's true. And it's not something that I'm focused – that I personally am focused on. I feel like Jill Stein's harm that she did was before the election, and was kind of her overall vibe that bugs me. But I haven't spent a lot of time thinking about whether she took the election from Hillary or not.
Can I know you're a big supporter of Hillary.
Yes.
And to me, criticizing Hillary to Hillary,
which I have many times. It's not that I don't ever criticize.
It's like criticizing the police and the military.
Uh-huh.
Hear me out. If you criticize the most powerful, strongest people in our society, the police and the military, people will say, "Oh, how dare you! You know, they're the best we the best we have to offer, and these people give so much, and you hate America." And what really incenses me is, of course, the police and the military are heroes, but don't portray them as weak and vulnerable and not worthy of some criticism.
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing goes with, I find, Clinton supporters, mm-hmm. is that here she is. She's like the military. She's like the police.
Mm-hmm.
She's the strongest, most well-armed person in America.
Except for one thing.
What?
She's a woman.
Well, hang on.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's like anytime you criticize Hillary, you people get so upset, mm-hmm. and you think, well, wait a second. Why should Hillary, the police, or the military get to
none of them
be weak?
None of them should be beyond criticism.
And play the weak card.
None of them should be beyond criticism. In Hillary's case, it has something to do with the fact that for 25 years she's received nothing but unfair criticism from the Washington establishment.
Until she became the Washington establishment.
She's no more the Washington establishment than Obama is, you know. And she's just has had a constant 25-year barrage of unfair, unfounded accusations against her, and the ground zero of it all is her being a woman. But that doesn't mean that if you're attacking her, you're being a misogynist. But that's kind of at the core of all of the hatred towards her. And this year was the accumulation that kind of, you didn't think that after Whitewater and all the bullshit scandals that anything could top that. But this year, in a year when Donald Trump was running for president, the main thing that the media focused on, and this is statistically true, they covered this story more than every other story combined, was her emails, which was a bullshit, fake, made-up scandal by the media, and they covered it more than anything else. So it's fine. It's valid to criticize Hillary about whatever you want to criticize her for, but she's a unique case. So people like me who support her were always kind of on the alert for people making not criticizing her, but criticizing her for fake bullshit things, which it seems like is most of the criticism she ever gets. She's considered a scandal-prone politician. There has never been a Hillary Clinton scandal ever, not one. They're all bullshit. They're all fake. They're all made up.
Hillary's biggest problem is the fact that when her husband's career started, he was so charismatic that people who were trying to take him down realized he is untouchable, but his wife is a perfect target.
Right.
And that was the catalyst. It was, this guy is so – I mean, Bill Clinton was just amazing at making you like him.
Yeah.
And
he still is.
Yeah. And they were just like, you know what? People aren't going to buy it. But they look at this – but she was, at the time, just perfect. Just a feminist in the 70s,
mm-hmm.
you know, just so ideal to start lining up ways of
not knowing her proper place in the world.
And I will say there's an attitude that attacking Hillary during the presidential campaign was akin to being in World War II and throwing rocks at your own side because that guy fucked my wife.
Right.
Okay. Listen, I voted for Hillary. I wanted Bernie.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if Bernie could have beaten Trump. I don't know.
We'll never know for sure.
The polls indicated that he would, but
you can't go by polls that happened before during the primary. They're
right.
Irrelevant now. The polls said that Hillary was going to win the election.
And I would say that if Bernie was running against Trump, Trump would have said every day, oh, boy, I'm glad Hillary didn't make it. She would have been a lot tougher than this old moron. Like, we have no idea the level that they would have destroyed his character and talked about him being a communist, all the ways that they could have attacked him. You know, it's very easy to look at that now. I mean, look, the Republican Party was lionizing Bernie Sanders as a way of undermining Hillary. So it's so hard to know how that would have gone.
Yeah.
And I would have been happy with him as president. Absolutely.
Bernie? I would have voted for him. I would have been happy to vote for him.
I
applauded his behavior in the general election. Mm-hmm. Unlike a lot of Bernie supporters who didn't follow his lead, Bernie was, he campaigned for Hillary. He made speeches on her behalf. He supported her just as I said all year that the only really effective third party candidate this year was Bernie Sanders, and the reason why he was an effective third-party candidate was because he ran as a Democrat.
Let me offer this up about America. First of all, Hillary won by more than 2 million votes.
Yes.
So this autopsy that the Democrats are conducting, what did we do wrong? You didn't do anything wrong other than make sure the votes got counted in the swing states, and this idea of reexamining identity politics is a fool's errand, because identity politics still works. It is irrelevant to the white men in the Rust Belt. But our side won. Their side made it impossible for people of color to vote.
Right.
And have their votes counted. Mm. They should be running the Academy Awards, the Republican Party. Mm. They're so good at keeping black people from voting. But
the Oscars.
What I do think that Trump, and he lost.
Mm-hmm.
He lost.
He got less votes, yes.
Got fewer votes.
But he is our next president because of a system put in place hundreds of years ago by slave owners. So he gets to be president.
He lost the Electoral College if people were allowed to vote. This is not what America wants. This is not who we are.
No.
More Democrats got votes for Congress than Republicans. But because of gerrymandering, we have a Republican Congress. This is not who this country is. If we're going to do an autopsy, though, on somebody who's still alive, the Democratic Party, because I don't think, you know, the Republicans had their autopsy in 2012. They really were dead, and we're not dead. But the mistake we might have made by not running Bernie is one thing about this country is, and love of country, is you have to have faith in our country. And I think nominating Hillary Clinton was a lack of faith.
Really?
Yeah, because this country is all about the new. New ideas. We have a revolution in this country every 2 years with Congress, like a new Congress. And everybody says this is a different presidential election. This time it's different. Yes, every time we have a new president, it's different. We want a clean slate and we like to gamble. Mm-hmm. We have faith enough in the system that we're willing to gamble on Trump.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe Barack Hussein Obama.
Mm-hmm.
Barack Hussein Obama could have given us Bernie Sanders. I think that this country is bold enough and daring enough to elect a 74-year-old socialist.
But not bold and daring enough to elect a woman, apparently.
You know, I think it's great to have a woman president.
Mm-hmm.
But that's identity politics, and if it's,
but you just said that there's nothing wrong with identity politics.
There's nothing wrong with it.
Uh-huh.
But was she the right woman?
I think so.
Better than Elizabeth Warren?
I think she's a better candidate than Elizabeth Warren. I think she'd be a better president than Elizabeth Warren.
I agree with you, but if you can't win.
Well, she did win.
Well, yes, she did.
Are you saying that the only reason Obama
did
so well is because you can't be a moderate Democrat unless you have some kind of crazy name? That the idea that, like, because he was Barack Hussein Obama, that made people okay with – well, then again, no, because at the time a moderate Democrat after Bush was a break from the norm.
Right. George W. Bush made Barack Obama possible.
Right.
And Donald Trump will probably in 2004, hopefully in 2018 – and then 2020 will make people possible who weren't possible before. That's a potential positive result. But I don't like the idea, and a lot of progressives say this, that a lot – you know, Ralph Nader kind of had the attitude too that electing Bush was better because it was in 2000 because it would tear down the system and it would create a explode. I'm not willing to see – The amount of suffering that happened under Bush and the amount of suffering that's going to happen under Trump is, to me, too high price of pay to get a good candidate the next time around.
The suffering that took place under Bush lies at the feet of the Democratic Party.
Really?
Yes.
For not standing.
Tom Daschle was the Senate Majority Leader when he got the war authorization. Mm. Tom Daschle was a Democrat. The Democrats had a majority in the Senate in 2002.
Okay.
It was, and all Tom Daschle had to do was say no.
Mm-hmm.
All Hillary Clinton had to do with Iraq was say no. Those tax cuts that went through under George W. Bush could have been stopped by the Democratic Party. The same way the Republicans stopped a lot of
The Democrats are culpable in the Iraq War, absolutely, as was the media at the time. Bush and Cheney couldn't have done it on their own. They got the media behind them, and the Democratic leadership was filled with fear, and they went along with it because of 9/11. And absolutely,
the Democrats made the mistake of not questioning 9/11 when it happened. Mm-hmm. Had it happened under Clinton, the Republicans would. I'm all for an adversarial system. I believe, you know, I hate lawyers, but if you're going to have a trial, you need one side fervently fighting for its side.
And I said during the Obama administration about all the Republican obstruction, which I didn't care for, but when people on the, like the radio shows I were on would criticize them, I would say, yeah, but obstruction isn't necessarily a bad thing. The Democrats needed to be more obstructionist during Bush's presidency. And I hope that the Democrats will be incredibly obstructionist.
They're not
now.
Going to be.
I'm going to be part of the chorus that's going to try. If Chuck Schumer is going to work with, collaborate with Trump, it'll be a really messed up thing.
Bernie is saying to collaborate on the infrastructure.
Bernie, but
oh, that's giving him a noose though. That's just giving Trump a noose because we all know he's not really going to spend $3 trillion on infrastructure. So for the Democrats, this is a perfect time for us to say yes, we fully support this, so that we can give him enough rope because we know it's not going to happen, and then we can.
Well, what the Republican Congress
say, we tried to help you.
But the Republican Congress can make it happen, though.
They won't,
you know.
But they never will. They hate infrastructure.
What,
Sandy? The Republicans? They don't want to spend money on.
Oh, maybe that. But we're in serious trouble in this country because Trump is very charming.
Really?
Oh, come on. He's funny. He's charming. He gave that interview with the New York Times earlier this week.
Which they were all laughing at, the transcript. And the New York Times, by the way, they're very culpable in the Trump presidency. And they're all, and speaking of normalizing him and treating him as someone that reasonable people should work with, the Times is at the forefront of that, despite the best efforts of Charles Blow and Paul Krugman.
Okay, I will defend the New York Times the way you defend Hillary, but let me get back to Trump and the dangers of Trump and why the Democratic Party is really just disappointing and a danger to our republic. We need a two-party system in this country, and the Democrats are rolling over. They are rolling over. And what I was saying is that Trump met with the New York Times, and I smiled, and he backtracked on everything. Mm-hmm. Everything. He's not going to lock Hillary up. Global warming might be man-made. Mm-hmm.
But that's because at that moment he was in the room with people that saying that would make them like he's like that. When he was with the Mexican president, he didn't talk about the wall or anything.
Right.
When he was in that church with that woman who confronted him, I forget the whole story, but he was very gracious to her. He's a coward. He doesn't confront people
who are stronger than him.
Who are stronger than him, which is why at that other media meeting, apparently he yelled at Jeff Zucker, because Jeff Zucker is a weakling who put Corey Lewandowski and Jeffrey Lord and all these Trump surrogates, Scotty Nell Hughes, on his network, did everything he
CNN.
Could. Yes, who did everything he could to suck up to Donald Trump, and that Donald Trump doesn't respect that. That makes that person a weak person that he can yell at.
Right. This is why you have to stand up to him.
Yes.
Time stamp this episode. This is the weekend after Thanksgiving, right? This is Black. Mm-hmm. We're launching this on the Thanksgiving Day weekend. Okay. Hang on for one second. Time stamp this. Donald Trump is a failure as a man, as a human being, as a businessman. He has zero money, zero competence. He's a huckster. He is a failed businessman who turned to politics the same way George W. Bush turned to politics, because he was a failure as a businessman. There is going to be a terrorist attack in this country big time, because Trump surrounds himself with sycophants as opposed to competent people who care about government. So there's going to be a terrorist attack. And what happens when there's a terrorist attack in this country? The Democrats and the media get scared, mm-hmm. and they rally around the flag, mm-hmm. and the president.
Mm-hmm.
And that is the time when you don't do that.
Right.
That is when you ask the questions. Giuliani, why did you put the command center at the top of the World Trade Center
when you were told not to, for exactly the reasons of what happened?
Right. So all the charm offensive that's going on now with Trump.
Which, and don't forget George W. Bush, another guy who charmed the New York Times. People forget how favorable the Times coverage of George W. Bush was, as opposed to the coverage of Al Gore, which was mostly negative.
Right. But so be very wary, because once we have a terrorist attack in this country under Trump, and we will, because you need a commander in chief in the Situation Room who wakes up every morning and gets his intelligence briefings, which Donald Trump is not doing. Mm-hmm. He's only had two intelligence briefings mm-hmm. so far. We're letting our guard down. And then what does he do? He's going to divert. He's going to deflect the attention of his incompetence onto scapegoats and a country overseas that has brown people. And what are we going to do?
Well, if we go, if it's a repetition of what we did after 9/11, then, and there's a good chance it would be, the media and the Congress will just go along with him. I have a very slim hope that because 9/11 happened already, and because of history, and because this is Donald Trump, that maybe people won't be so quick to get on board with him. But like I said, that's a very slim hope.
Well, why are we not insisting that we audit the vote? Hang on for one second. Hillary Clinton.
Uh-huh.
This is my criticism of Hillary Clinton. Mm. I voted for her.
Right.
Because she could win. Mm-hmm. Now, she won. But I voted for her because I wanted her to win, to
you vote for a Clinton because they teach us how to win. They roll up their sleeves and they have a ground game and they have lawyers, lawyers, lawyers. Both Hillary and Bill are lawyers. They surround themselves with lawyers. Why are they not fighting?
Because maybe they think that they, unlike people like Jill Stein, or unlike a lot of people, I'm sure they've looked into it, and their opinion is probably that a recount isn't going to get them over the finish line.
But why give a fascist legitimacy? If it were the other way around, if the shoe were on the other tiny foot and it was Trump who won the popular vote but not the electoral vote.
Yeah, they would be doing all that.
Why are we not fighting going into the trenches the same way they are? Even if you lose the recount, you're denying him legitimacy.
Well, it's unprecedented to have a recount when there's more than one state necessary for that to turn things. But now we're talking about actual ideas that this was rigged, that this was Russia changing the percentages of votes if they weren't paper ballots.
But not through, but the idea, and this is, and I could be wrong, just from what I read, the idea that the Russians hacked the electoral count is very far-fetched. They did influence the election through fake news and through WikiLeaks and through traitors like Julian Assange. And
traitors like Julian Assange?
Yes, like Julian Assange.
Don't you have to be an American to be a traitor?
He's a traitor to his embassy.
Ecuador? By the way, there's a great article in the Washington Post, in Friday's Washington Post, about how the Russians had a concerted effort.
Yeah, they influenced and manipulated the election. That is very plausible.
In terms of the news, in terms of propaganda.
Right, in terms of the news. But the idea that they had hackers who went into electoral booths from afar and switched the vote tally, that is very far-fetched.
You know what this reminds me of? Because we're coming up on we just came up on the Kennedy assassination, the anniversary of the Kennedy assassination. And it's don't go there. With the Kennedy assassination, the same thing with Contragate. Mm-hmm. Do not go there, girlfriend, because you're staring into the abyss. And the thing about the hacking, you barely, with all due respect, can barely open your laptop and get it to work. You don't know anything about hacking. Either do I. And we don't know.
I'm going by what people who do know about hacking say.
Nobody knows anything.
Then if nobody knows anything about hacking, then, you know, then nobody can operate a computer. I mean,
well, the Navy just got hacked. 150,000 seamen. Anybody?
I'll let that one pass. I don't.
150,000 seamen.
The tense is wrong for us to make a pun out of it.
Okay. Yeah. 150,000.
It has to be.
I'm afraid if I told that joke, it would end up all over my face. So,
well done.
150,000 seamen had their identities hacked. The Navy. The Navy was hacked this past week. The Navy. The Pentagon got hacked. So why is it so far-fetched to think that somebody...
I'm not saying it couldn't happen, but I'm just saying from what I've read, that just seems like an unlikely scenario. It could happen, but to me it goes into this whole thing of what Bernie supporters and Jill Stein supporters, it's always about how the system is rigged and how that's the reason people lose. The reason Bernie didn't win the primary is because the DNC rigged the election, and if it weren't for the Debbie Wasserman Schultz, Bernie would have been the nominee, and all that stuff is bullshit. So I could be wrong, but all of that, this kind of thinking all ties into that for me, especially with Jill Stein being a part of it.
Kurt Eichenwald, who writes for Newsweek.
Yes, and he's the best there is, just about.
And he's been a guest on this show. He's the best there is. He has a great piece, look it up, about how Debbie Wasserman Schultz couldn't possibly rig.
I read that piece, yes. And it was all about how naive Bernie supporters are.
Yeah, unenacted plans didn't make a million people vote for Hillary Clinton.
Yeah.
Everything that John Podesta and Deborah Wasserman Schultz talked about that may or may not have been wrong, none of it was enacted. None of it actually happened. It was just conversations. Could we
right.
do this? Can we? They, people, oh, they wanted to put New Jersey and New York at the front of the primary. Yeah, and where were New Jersey and New York in the primary? At the end. So obviously it did not happen.
Right.
I'm going to go back to the Kennedy assassination. Lyndon Johnson's biggest concern was that the Russians killed Kennedy and that we would have had World War III.
And that it was...
And our biggest concern right now in the Situation Room is that the Russians hacked Wisconsin, Pennsylvania, and Michigan. Because what does that mean? What does that mean? What does that say? Because it says that we're not counting the votes here in America. And, you know, Jimmy Carter, President Jimmy Carter, who, until he got sick, traveled all over the world verifying Democratic elections. And what did he say about our system of politics, our democracy? Do you know what he said?
What?
Jimmy Carter said he could not verify the votes here in the United States, that this is as bad as any African or Latin American country. You cannot verify the votes here in America. That is the lie about our democracy. And we rather perpetuate that lie than do a recount. We rather have Donald Trump ruin this country because the Clintons are afraid to open up that Pandora's box. Well, it is.
No, it isn't. That's such bullshit.
No, no.
That's such bullshit.
It's a Pandora's box.
Don't you think if the Clintons thought that they could win through a recount that they would do it?
No, they don't think it would be good for the country, and they don't think it would be good for their brand.
What about all I've been hearing about Hillary Clinton for 25 years, about how she's this manipulative person who'll do anything to achieve power?
That's why I voted for her, and doesn't care about ethics
or anything, will just do anything to achieve power. So why isn't this caricature of her exists now? Why isn't she the one that's doing everything?
The caricature is stopping her from fighting this because she's been branded as this ambitious maniac because obviously women can't be ambitious in politics.
Right.
And that is exactly why she had, when this happened, I said, there's no way. There's no way she's going to come out and say this was rigged because everyone just has this preconceived perception of her as this person. I don't think she is. And it's perfect. They've branded her in such a way that she cannot fight this because everyone just says, oh, you're such a – this is exactly what we thought
about
you.
Well, also, but if that's the case too, if the recount happens and she's given the election without her having participated in it, that's good for her.
Very good.
That's good for if
oh,
in the slight
because she took the high road.
Yeah,
I didn't vote for her to take the high road.
Well,
I voted for a Clinton.
But you see, you voted for the cliche bullshit Clinton. You voted for the Clinton that you read about in the New York Times, who will do anything to make money for their charitable foundation and who manipulate everything. So yeah, you voted for the fictional Clinton, but I voted for the real Clinton.
I want to win. See, I want my side to slap people around and crack skulls.
I do. I'm kind of in the middle between that because I do think that it was all exaggerated. But at the same time, I do see her as this ruthless, very intelligent woman who was willing,
an ambitious politician.
Go ahead,
yes.
Put money in my charity. See if you get a favor out of it. You probably won't, but I'm not going to stop you putting money in that charity. That's the kind of ruthlessness I kind of liked in there.
Look, I don't think Trump is smart.
No.
I have zero respect for him. And I do think that there's some dark force behind him.
That
he doesn't even know the dark force that's behind him. The same way George W. Bush didn't understand the dark force behind him. Trump, though, has a guttural, gut, visceral knowledge of the street and how to win, or at least
what street?
Fifth Avenue.
Okay.
He understands how to look like he's winning. Stand-up – I'm making a larger point here. This is idiot stand-up comics the comics who constantly scream, I just got ripped off, what do they all have in common? Every stand-up comic you know who walks up to you and says, oh, I can't believe he did my joke. You know, my jokes are being ripped off all the time. What do those guys all share?
Easy jokes.
No. But what else?
Their hacks.
That. But what is the common denominator of every stand-up comic who can't stop complaining that they're being ripped off?
That they're not powerful enough to...
They're thieves. Oh. Every comic who complains all the time about their jokes getting ripped off, to a man or woman, but mm-hmm. mostly men, they are thieves.
Mm-hmm.
I learned it a long time ago that mm-hmm. you complain about the thing you are. For example, Marcus Bachman,
mm-hmm.
Michelle Bachman's yeah. husband. He's gay.
We can all see mm-hmm. it.
While he's praying away you're gay, mm-hmm. he's gay.
Allegedly.
Donald Trump kept saying, the system is rigged. The system is rigged. You got to get out there, monitor the vote. They're going to steal it from us. Why did he say that? Because he figured, if we're doing this, they're doing this. So I better start saying the system is rigged. He knew something was up, and he also invited, I mean, this is not really worth bringing up, but he did invite the Russian government.
Yeah, he literally said it. And I've seen a few computer programming professors talking about this, saying that they could show the government right now how they could have done it. That them and their students could have rigged an election. And I'm not saying it happened. This isn't one of those things where I'm like, I know this one way or the other. But think about how terrifying it is, the idea that in a closed door meeting, Donald Trump is going to sit down with Vladimir Putin, and Putin is going to say, we rigged the election. And if you don't want the American public to know that, here's what you're going to do for us. And we just made a mole of the U.S. president.
Yeah, that's John Fugel saying. Has made the point that Trump is not going to become Hitler, but he's going to allow Putin to become Hitler. They're going to make some kind of deal that makes Trump look good, and then Putin is just going to be allowed to invade every country that he wants to invade.
So he'll be the Stalin to World War II. Mm-hmm. Stalin created a pact with Hitler. I don't look.
He's Mussolini. Let's not go crazy.
I think actually Mussolini had more hair than Trump. Look, I'm optimistic because I have to be. And I know that politics is compromised, but you need people like me deep down in the internet on a podcast that not too many people listen to. We're the ones who have to constantly be vigilant and ask these questions, because you've got to you cannot stop now and just accept Trump. You mm-hmm. can't. And deep down here, where you know we're not mainstream media, we're not manufacturing consent. We need people to look into this.
But one problem is for one thing, if Hillary becomes president under these circumstances, she won't be able to govern. However, Hillary not governing is better than Trump governing.
Yeah.
But if on December 15th the electors give Hillary the election, or if it's decided, that first of all, that would be a result that Trump would love. Trump would love that result. I think the one thing that Trump hates about his life right now is that he's actually the president. I think the opposite result of this election would have been Donald Trump's dream to have won the popular vote and not have to serve as president, and to be able to brag all the time that you're the real winner but not have any of the responsibilities. That's the cruel trick that God is playing on Donald Trump right now.
How do you know that?
What?
See, that's soothing. That's what we like to believe.
No, I believe that because I think that that's an enjoyable lifestyle for Trump.
That's you projecting.
Well, I project on everything based on my observations
on people. I think there's evidence of that. The evidence is that Donald Trump has never shown any actual hunger for governance. He's never shown any real interest in the power, the real power of the presidency. He only wants the pageantry. He wants every part of the job Hillary did not want.
Which is why he's going to be a fascist.
Right. He offered John Kasich to be president.
Yes, exactly. And that's what's going to happen with Mike Pence.
Right. We're going to have another prime minister like we had with Dick Cheney.
Yeah.
Prior results do not dictate the future. What you're doing is you're basing things on history.
Mm-hmm.
When you do that, it travels up.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I don't mean to be a pain in the ass. But what you're doing, you really are running the danger of projecting your goodness and your rationale onto somebody who's irrational and not good and somebody you don't understand. I don't understand Trump.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what's going on.
Well, I mean, granted that, but the point that I was heading towards is that if suddenly these things happen, there's a recount, the electors give her the vote. If she becomes president under those circumstances, in some ways, Trump will still be as powerful because he'll be a very powerful disruptive force, and he won't go away at all. He'll be more, but Hillary becoming president is still probably, even under these circumstances, is probably a better result, but it's a shit show either way.
Well, I don't mean to be – I love having you here. I love this conversation, and it's giving me insight into the problem with our side,
mm-hmm.
how you and I completely agree on everything,
mm-hmm.
but how we get there, mm-hmm. we don't agree on. You – in many ways, are a typical, with all due respect, mm-hmm. and you know how much I love mm-hmm. you are a typical liberal. You don't want to win unless you win the right way. And I don't think you understand the power of the presidency in that once he becomes president.
Oh, I understand that. And I said just a minute ago that Hillary winning under these circumstances is still a better is still probably better for us.
Not probably. Why do you say probably?
Because I'm just taking into account all the problems.
What are the problems you envision?
Extremely tainted. They would be emboldened to basically delegitimize her.
And the Republican.
You pussies! You liberal pussies! The two of you.
The Republicans.
You are what's wrong.
I'm just talking about the reality of what would happen under those circumstances. You would have Trump. You would have a media sympathetic to Trump. For instance, the New York Times. Constantly not letting Hillary do anything as president, a constant barrage of everyone in the media treating her as an illegitimate president. Donald Trump didn't win the popular vote, and this has been pointed out by a lot of other writers. If this whole situation were reversed and Hillary was the president with the electoral vote and Donald Trump had won the popular vote, you'd be reading nothing but stuff in the media about how we're in a crisis mode right now, how Hillary is not really legitimate. She doesn't have a mandate. You never read anything like that about Donald Trump ever in any mainstream publication. So I'm saying that Hillary, I'm just acknowledging the reality of Hillary becoming president under these circumstances, which is still better than Trump being president, but I'm just saying it would be a total shit show and she'd never get anything done. But like I said, her not governing is better than Trump governing.
Right, and I think, go ahead.
I was just going to say, and
I still think you're a pussy.
I'd kind of like it. I would kind of like it if Hillary legitimately was made president because they found that there was actual hacking or something. And then you would have obviously millions of Trump voters who were 100% sure, oh, this is just the government. None of this is real. Everything I want to believe is true. I would actually like them to feel like not only that they did win the election and they had it taken away from them, because that's how demoralized I want that faction of Trump's people to be.
And you're a pussy. I don't know. You're both pussies.
I want them.
But also, you know.
And my listeners are pussies.
Taking into account.
Everybody's a pussy.
Taking into account how awful the moment that Trump is sworn in his presidency, taking into account how overwhelmingly awful that is. In some ways, I still think the better, the more hopeful course is for I'm kind of joining up with Ralph Nader and Jimmy Dore, kind of like now that this has all happened, I'm kind of like joining up in the let it all go crazy so that it can be fixed camp.
Ralph Nader isn't saying that.
Well, he has been saying that for a long. He said that about George Bush.
That was 16 years ago.
But my point is that the better way to go that I see as a hopeful result of the situation we're in is that Trump becomes president, and then Democrats and progressives, rather than doing what they always do, sitting out the midterms, becoming disinterested in politics the moment their candidate is sworn in, and then letting the Republicans get control of the Congress in the midterms. My hope is that Democrats and progressives will become like the Tea Party in 2010 and really work hard to get progressive and better candidates in and make a big change in the Congress in 2018, and then get a truly progressive person into the White House in 2020. That, to me, that's not an ideal path, because it still has Trump as president, which makes it incredibly dangerous. But considering the situation we're in right now, I see that as the more viable path to fix this shit. Hillary becoming president under these circumstances doesn't necessarily fix the situation that we're in.
And I think that
I disagree.
I think that with Trump, the best case scenario, that is a realistic one, is the idea that this scares the shit out of liberals into realizing maybe there are more important people to go after than a guy who didn't realize that Halloween costume was offensive. And I'm not even discounting saying that we should be continuing to say what is and is not, okay in polite society, but that you have to stop, like Bill Maher says, you have to stop concentrating on the people on your side to whittle down the number of people that count as progressive until it's an edgy enough and small enough group that you feel cool enough to be a part of, and say, no, there's a real enemy on the other side that you need to stop whittling down who's on your side to get.
Okay, I we'll get to that in a second. But I meant to raise my voice, and I hope to.
No, you're raising your voice has no effect because you're such a pussy.
First of all, I'm learning a lot by listening to you. And I'll move on, but I just want to process this for a second. Your hopefulness, your optimism.
If Trump becomes president, that is the hopefulness that I'm clinging to.
But don't you think that if you want our side to be as organized and angry as the Tea Party, that we have to demand an audit of the vote now, that we have to fight? Don't you think if we're going to usher in a progressive moment, don't we have to be the Tea Party and just right now delegitimate?
If they want to do an audit.
But why aren't you getting worked up about this? I mean, you love Hillary.
I do.
So why?
I'm following her lead on this.
Why?
Because it doesn't seem that viable.
But, yes. but Hillary says, make me do it.
Hillary lives in the real world.
No, I live in the real world. I live in the real world. I have to pay. I have bills that have to be paid.
Right.
I live in the real world.
But so does Hillary.
No, she doesn't.
Yes, she does.
No. If by numbers, she's part of the 1%, 99%.
But there are people in the 1% who care about people who aren't in the 1%.
But you're saying she lives in the real world because she understands politics?
She understands politics.
And why didn't she win?
She understands.
If she won, why didn't she win?
Well,
if she lives in the real world and she's so smart and she's a lawyer, she won, but she didn't win.
Well, because by living in the real world, she didn't think that Wisconsin and Michigan were going to be the problems that they were. And they were, But she couldn't have predicted that. Every poll told her that that she was going to win in those places.
So she doesn't live in the real world.
Well, but you can live in the real world and be wrong about stuff.
So if the polls
But she's a person who is has always been, what is the pragmatic way to affect change in this world? You know, and how not just being an outsider on the fringe, how does a person like myself who wants to make positive change in the world, how does a person like myself achieve power and make that positive change that I deep in my heart want to make happen?
And so why, as a Clinton supporter, I'm really curious, because you're giving me insight into why we're never going to be the Tea Party.
Mm-hmm.
You have a president who you wanted you more than Bernie.
Since day one, yes.
Okay. She believes in the Roosevelt mission, which is my heart's in the right place, but you got to make me do it. That's what Roosevelt said to all the progressives during the New Deal. Mm-hmm. I can't do it unless you make me do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'll move to the left. Hillary moved to the left.
She was moving to the left. She was preparing a progressive
Because Bernie made her do it.
Yes.
Bernie made her
do it.
And
absolutely.
She said that pretty much. She said, I reflect, you know, this idea that politics is bad and that you're a weather vane. That is what a politician's supposed to do. You're supposed to represent your constituents. And if your party is moving to the left, you move to the left. There's there's nothing ignoble about that. But my question to you is, why aren't you making Hillary do it? Why aren't you getting on the audit the vote
thing? I'm in no position to make her do it. And my feeling is that if Hillary is not pursuing it, it's because she doesn't feel it's a viable thing.
But she's always going to choose the path that, unless her supporters push her, she's not going to do anything.
There's no evidence to support that.
Well, why would
she just got railroaded by a country that believes she lives in the real world? The country doesn't. Uh-huh. Most people who voted for Trump believe at least one thing that is provably false about Hillary Clinton.
Right.
They believe that 3 million illegal aliens voted. Mm-hmm. That is a proven hoax, and millions believe
that. I'm belaboring. We're going to move on. Let me get the last word, and then you can get the last word. Because Hillary won, but she didn't. So everything is true.
Right. She's still the choice of the country.
Yeah. Everything is true. So I'm going to get the last word, and then you can get the last word. And I hate to belabor this, but you cannot treat Hillary the same way we treat our police and military.
Mm.
We have a strong military. We have a strong police. And we have a strong Hillary. Don't portray them as victims or weak. These are very strong, well-armed.
I don't recall portraying her as a victim or as weak.
Well, you're kind of portraying her as high-minded.
High-minded, yes.
Who's afraid to roll up her sleeves.
She's afraid to roll up her sleeves, a person who's been working nonstop for her entire life to make things happen. But she's not rolling up her sleeves. Because she doesn't have a podcast like us.
I think she just doesn't want to be remembered as pathetic and not willing to accept when it was over.
I
think that's a big part of this.
That's a big part. Well, you know what? That's not my problem. It's not about her. You know, when she wins, she would say, this isn't about me. It's about us. This is about us. This is a movement. You know, it's not just her ego. There are going to be 30 million people who are going to lose health insurance because she doesn't want to be remembered a certain way.
She doesn't want to be remembered.
I don't care how she gets remembered. You know, when you're the party nominee, it's not you, it's the party, and you have an obligation to what we represent.
Mm-hmm.
I don't care about her ego.
As far as she's concerned, this recount is not about what we represent. To her and to people like me, it smacks more of that kind of Bernie Jill Stein kind of everything is unfair, everything is rigged, and nobody gets anything fairly. So that's why we haven't won. She's looking at the reality of why she didn't win because she didn't get the electoral vote. She got 2.5 million more votes than Trump, but the reality is just like the reality was for Gore, and Gore could have fought that thing a lot more than he did. And some people say he should have. But yeah. he also looked at the reality of it and realized that
he owns, I can go and sell Current for $400 million.
They're both Moneyball Democrats. This is Moneyball. If there's a 49% chance that they're going to win, they're not going to take it. And maybe that's wrong.
Maybe that's wrong.
Wait a minute. You know, Hillary did. She ran in the primary. She ran a campaign. She worked her ass off to win 2.5 million more votes. And you're sitting here portraying her as this person who won't get off her ass.
Yes.
That's bullshit.
No, it isn't. That's complete bullshit.
It's typical of kind of a left of a far left view of things that she's not being contentious enough and just bitter about things enough for the left.
You know who fights dirty? George W. Bush, Karl Rove, Trump.
I thought Hillary fought dirty. That's the way she was portrayed for 25 years as someone who fought dirty. Now your problem is she doesn't fight dirty enough.
I don't care how she fights. I care about my party and my ideology, and I care about the 99%. Mm-hmm. And who's going to fight? Who's going to wait?
I think Hillary has done a lot to fight for them. And the fact that she's either fighting this in her own way by not putting her name on it and hoping that it turns out without her name, or she's realizing that this isn't where the fight is. Maybe the fight is fighting everything that Trump does. And how about the election in Louisiana where we could get a Democratic Senate? Nobody is focusing on that. Everybody is focusing on this fucking recount, and it's bullshit.
It's not. I'm going to get the last word, and then you can have the last word. You know, Obamacare is deeply flawed. We need single payer. There should have been a public option. Mm. That being said, it's saving lives. And I know people who are beneficiaries of Obamacare. And the way Obamacare stayed alive was through reconciliation. It was very detailed work. It couldn't pass the House, but Harry Reid moved it through in the Senate as a reconciliation bill, which was kind of dirty, wasn't really true. But that's how you do it. And then John Roberts, is that his name? The Supreme Court chief? John Roberts. Had a moment of clarity and said, it's a tax. Mm-hmm. It's a tax. And saved Obamacare. Saving lives like that is you twist and you turn and you fight and you argue and it hinges on.
And then a recount is completely different from that.
It is?
Yes, because a recount isn't legislation. A recount isn't negotiating with one person so that you'll get this and negotiating with another person so you get that. That's what Hillary would have been like had she been elected. A recount is literally that, recounting the votes.
Well, it's emblematic. No, I disagree, because if you win by one vote, you won. If you win by reconciliation, or you know what, it's a tax, you win. And Hillary and Bill are really not living in the real world, and are seduced by big money, which is why Bill Clinton, when you look back on his presidency, was really not that great a president.
He was flawed.
Flawed. Sure. He was an extension of the Reagan wave. And he triangulated and he gave us, you know, he overthrew Glass-Steagall, the telecommunications bill.
Both awful things.
I mean, you complain about the media. It's the Clintons. It's the Telecommunications Act of 1996. You complain about our economy and Wall Street. It's the repeal of Glass-Steagall. Welfare reform under Bill Clinton. What did he accomplish as president other than telling the Democrats, hey, we can win. We can look at me. I'm winning. What did Bill Clinton, what can you point at?
So now you're criticizing Bill for winning and criticizing Hillary for not having bills.
I'm saying that they don't represent me. I voted for her. I wanted Bernie. But the Clintons do not represent my ideology. I don't have a law degree from Yale. Mm-hmm. I'm not as smart as they are. I can't make the kind of money they can when they want to make money.
Mm-hmm.
They do not represent
that doesn't mean, though, that they don't care about people who don't make that kind
well,
of money.
Well, welfare. What about welfare reform?
Hillary, that was not Hillary. That was Bill.
Hillary gave us chips. Mm-hmm. And I'm a big fan of Eric Estrada. But they really are the corporate wing of the Democratic Party.
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
And
that doesn't mean they can't do good.
It does.
Barack Obama is also corporatist as a president.
That's right.
But how come he doesn't get nearly the amount of criticism that Hillary gets
for having
very cozy relationships with Wall Street?
That's a charisma deficit.
Huh?
Tell me, Hillary Clinton tried to give us some kind of health care in 93 and 94.
Yes.
Tell me what she's done for our country.
When she didn't get that kind of health care, she passed the health care
chips
for children.
That was great.
Yes.
Okay. But tell me what the Clinton, and that's great. Mm-hmm. And I'm not arguing with you. And I voted for Hillary.
Mm-hmm.
But tell me what the Clintons have done for America. Point to some things that they didn't. What have the Clintons done for America? What's their legacy?
Their legacy is they've given the media something to hate.
No, seriously. What's the legacy of the Clintons? What can they point to?
She wasn't given the chance to
have Secretary of State, what did she accomplish?
I'm not cognizant of a foreign policy like that.
Okay, and what did Bill Clinton accomplish?
Good with the budget.
Surplus. A balanced budget.
Kosovo.
Yeah.
Kosovo
was good, yeah.
Prosperity for many Americans.
Which
not
was built on
enough.
Built on a lie, built on Greenspan's cheap, easy credit.
Well, okay. So,
but I agree with you that we had prosperity.
You're right. Everybody sucks. Let's just be cynical about the people in power.
Okay, so hang on for 1 second. I agree with you. Kosovo was a success. I think.
I mean, I'm not saying that other presidents couldn't have had the same success, but yeah, it was a good
Kosovo,
example.
Kosovo, but he did. Okay. He came to that. That was the last year of his presidency, 7 years. Bosnia and Herzegovina, that was a disaster, as was Rwanda. But I agree with you. I'll give you Kosovo. But when you say he gave us a budget surplus,
mm-hmm.
you're absolutely right.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what we elect a president to do?
Well, I think we want more from him. We want more from everybody.
What did he do for a budget surplus implies that there were, budget cuts that he couldn't really fight Newt Gingrich. Mm-hmm. So what did?
I don't know. I honestly don't know. I don't have an answer for you.
Okay. So what did the question I have for my listeners is,
and I want to know your motivations for the question.
Really?
Yes.
Well, we gave the Clintons, you get 2-for-1 with the Clintons. We gave them 8 years.
Mm-hmm.
They created.
They improved upon the previous administrations.
They improved upon. You mean Reagan and
Reagan
George
and Bush? Yes.
They improved upon.
They were better than the previous administration.
It could be said
they were better for the country. It's a much better thing that we elected Bill Clinton than electing Bob Dole or giving George Herbert Walker Bush a second term.
But he repealed Glass-Steagall.
That was I don't agree with that. I don't agree with him doing that.
Which created the
it was a huge mistake.
A huge mistake that allowed.
But what's your point then?
The point is that the Clintons really did not help our country.
You could call them
I
rebuilding.
Disagree.
You could call them what was necessary to rebuild the concept of the Democratic Party as not being traitors against America the way they were seen in the 80s, and that they were incrementalists who constantly compromised because that's how badly damaged the Democratic brand was at the time after people like Willie Horton were used to make Democrats look like these revolving door prison just hippies with no interest in defending lives. I think
I don't allow other people to define who I am. I don't allow Roger Ailes at the Republican or Lee Atwater with the Republicans to tell me who I am.
But you're not running for president either, though. You're saying I won't let them do that. A person running for president has to do a million things to become president. They have different choices to make than you as a citizen and a podcaster have to make.
Right. And
so you can't apply your standard of I'm not going to listen to that. I'm not going to let George Herbert Walker Bush or Ronald Reagan or Roger Ailes tell me how to live my life.
No, they
would. That's a different standard compared to someone who, when they're running for president, has to deal with those people, has to talk to those people, has to, as part of their job, they have to fight against those people. Those people have to be a factor in their lives. It's a completely different thing for somebody running and becoming president, how the way they deal with that than with you as just a citizen and a pod who don't, you have the luxury of saying, I don't have to deal with them. I don't have to let them define anything.
But President Obama didn't allow Ailes and Fox News.
President Obama was very similar to Bill Clinton in that he was a compromiser and he was an agent of incremental change. People on the left acted like he was a monster for trying to pass Obamacare because it didn't have single payer in it. People criticized him heavily. He did what he had to do, not to make things perfect, but to improve the world. I would say that with all of Bill Clinton's criticism, and I don't disagree with you, the world improved under his presidency as it did under Barack Obama's presidency. Now, you can say we have to do better. And you can say that someone like Hillary Clinton is just inadequate to make that happen. But now what we're stuck with is Donald Trump.
Okay. Go ahead. Take a moment. You going to go?
I got to just be right back.
Okay. We got to wrap it up. I'm having such a good time. Alex, we can't keep going, right? We have to wrap it up. Did you have fun?
Yeah.
This was good. We got to wrap it up. It should have been Elizabeth Warren.
I don't think she would have won, but.
Well, yeah. Recount the vote.
Mm-hmm.
And we should audit the vote.
Go ahead.
And go
ahead. Knock yourselves out.
You, like many God-fearing patriots, mm-hmm. you're afraid to look into that abyss
mm-hmm.
and realize that while we're busy trying to spread democracy around the world, ours doesn't exist.
Well,
our votes are not counted.
Mm-hmm.
They're not counted. And there are people who are very happy to live in the White House without the popular vote. George W. Bush and Trump have normalized mm-hmm. this. We have now gotten used to the idea that you don't need to win the popular vote.
Well, you don't.
And that what Americans want doesn't matter.
Doesn't. Well, how often does Congress cater to the will of the people? Probably just about never.
Okay. Folks, fight, fight, fight. Call your congressman. Call your senator. Demand a recount. Give money to Jill Stein. Fight, 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 fight. Give money to Planned Parenthood in the name of Mike Pence. How many was it? 50,000?
I haven't seen the number, but it's great. I'm sure it bothers him.
Give money to the ACLU. Mm-hmm. Fight, fight, fight. Boycott Tommy Hilfiger.
What did he do?
He's going to make Melania's gown. He said that it would be an honor to make Melania's inaugural gown.
What if it's fabulous?
That's true.
And go to Target.
Why?
Because the right wants to boycott Target for accommodating transgender bathrooms. Because you know how big an impact that has in their lives.
It's amazing how people reinvent themselves because Target used to be the most homophobic corporation.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
We used to have a good friend of mine did ads for Target, was hired.
I remember her.
And she had deep reservations about it. She actually went to an ethicist to talk about it.
Yeah, this was during the Obama administration. You know, and I know we have to wrap it up, Alex, but when you're one of the brightest people I know. I want you on the show all the time.
Thank you.
But when Frank and even I say, well, we learned our lesson from George W. Bush. We're not going to let Trump do what George W. Bush. People do not remember. And the fact that Target now can reinvent itself as pro-LGBTQ.
That's a positive thing.
It is a positive thing, but how quickly we forget
right.
that 4 years ago, they were right, like but the you epitome know what, of homophobia.
You know what the great thing is the reason they've changed is because the culture has changed. And as a corporation, they don't want to hurt their bottom line. And they've come to the conclusion that discriminating against transgender people will hurt their bottom line. And that's the people as the culture changing the world
great.
To the point
good
of
point.
Of millennials who old people like me like to make fun of. But millennials are the most tolerant generation ever in terms of accepting all different kinds of people because they grew up around gay people, around transgender people, around people of color. It's when I was a kid, and I go back a long way. I'm 60 years old. When I was a kid, it was easy for conservatives to portray anyone like that, gay, black, transgender, as the other, because you never saw them in our society. They were all hidden. They were all mm-hmm. in the shadows. Now that they're not hidden, now that the environment has changed so that people can come out and be who they are in the open more, and then other people meet them and go, hey, you know what, that guy, he's a cool guy. That gay guy who comes to the office party with his husband, they're cool people. They're fun to hang out with. I have no reason to fear them. I have no reason to hate them. And that's a hopeful sign that we, the people, as a culture, can affect the corporations in a positive way.
And the way you do that is they can't count our vote, but they can count our money.
Right, right.
And so when you spend money in this country, that's a much more powerful vote than voting for Hillary or Trump, unfortunately. The holiday season is upon us. As Robert Benchley said, the holiday season is around my neck, which is one of the funniest things. Once again, the holiday season is around my neck. You vote with your money. You don't need crap. Stop streaming your videos, your worthless videos. Start watching YouTube and listen to Noam Chomsky and Howard Zinn.
That'll perk you right up.
That'll perk you right up. Support podcasts like this. Listen to John Fugel saying, and more importantly, instead of getting your children or your parents something they don't need or food that's going to fatten them for the holidays, for $12 a month, you can give them a digital subscription to the New York Times.
Don't do that, though.
Or the Washington Post or the LA Times or your local newspaper. The Economist, The Nation Magazine, The Nation Magazine. If you subscribe to The Nation Magazine, every week, your parents or your loved ones will get a reminder that you love them in the mailbox. I'm wrapping it up. Okay, Alex. Give out subscriptions to mainstream media. Mainstream media. Support
that.
Mainstream media. Support The Nation. Progressive Magazine. Go to the Daily Kos.
I don't consider that mainstream, though.
Okay. Even Politico.
The New York Times is.
Read Politico.
Politico is.
Has gotten better. It had a right wing.
Really?
Yes, it has. Read The Hill.
It's I'm sure there's good stuff in Politico. There's a lot of bullshit in Politico.
When's the last time you went to Politico?
I go to Politico every day.
Politico's good. Go ahead.
We're
going to wrap it up.
I mostly read Yahoo News. I like to get my stuff nice in the middle. I want to know exactly what the rubes
are. You know everything. Dave Sirus, how do people follow you on
Twitter? You
should
go to Twitter. Dave, S-I-R-U-S, like virus.
Okay. And Frank Conniff.
Twitter, Frank Conniff, Frank Conniff on Facebook, my website, frankconniff.com.
Yes, and you have a new book out that everybody should buy. Mm-hmm. 25 Mystery Science Theater movies that changed my life in no way whatsoever.
Is Santa Claus versus the Martians on that one?
Yes, it is.
My favorite one.
I hope I never have to watch that movie.
Movie Sign with the Mads is your new...
Cave Comedy Radio and iTunes.
Okay. And Tell Me Everything Monday through Friday on Channel 121.
2 p.m. Eastern.
With
John Fugelsang.
On Sirius.
Yes.
From the Showbiz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That'll do it for us.
The David Feldman Radio Program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.